and welcome to the show. You are watching Big Deal and I am Nisha Poddar. All right, there has been a lot of action on the deal street this week and merger seems to be the flavor of the season. Firstly, let's take you through the top headlines this week. Treehouse Education Board approves a renegotiated merger with ZLearn and shareholders of Treehouse will get shares in ZLearn in the ratio of 1:1. Deal values Treehouse at 85% lower valuation than earlier. India's largest bank is all set to become bigger. State Bank of India announces a swap ratio to merge 6 smaller banks with itself and it will be 5 times bigger than its nearest competitor, ICICI Bank. Deal in the pipeline. Dish TV is set to announce the acquisition of Videocon D2H to create the largest direct-to-home player in India with over 45% market share. Sources tell CNBC TV 18 that the deal values Videocon D2H at around $1 billion. Piramal Enterprises is set to acquire US-based firm Ash Stevens in an all-cash deal amounting to close to 350 crore rupees. All right, so those were the top headlines for this week and a big deal got announced and it has gone through a lot of negotiations and back and forth. We're talking about Treehouse Education and ZLearn, where Treehouse Education bought and has finally approved its revised merger deal with ZLearn, and the deal had hit a roadblock, remember, after ZLearn had started re-evaluating its merger contours. First, let me take you through the details of this deal and what really transpired in the last few months.
The transaction between Treehouse and ZLearn has raised many questions. Final swap ratio is 1:1, valuing Treehouse at 85% lower than the valuation set only 8 months back. Swap ratio announced then was 5.3:1. That deal was called off. What has changed between December 2015 and now in Treehouse? In such a short time, a profitable company has turned loss-making in the last two quarters. From 150 crore rupees cash in September 2015, Treehouse saw massive erosion in cash due to high other expenses. Promoters of Treehouse have repledged their shareholding after releasing pledge just a few months back. All this while the deal talks were still on.
The share moved to as high as 450, 500 in the past about a year back. Then suddenly you see the fortunes of the company getting changed. So that clearly establishes that it was a case of price manipulation. I don't think that these all things will go unnoticed by the SEBI. If SEBI allows this to go, you know, to happen it, then anyone can, you know, have it at its own sweet will, can keep on changing the swap ratio. You have no meaning of timeline. You have no meaning of the guidelines. You have no meaning of the valuer certificate.
So that was the deal of this particular week. So Treehouse being bought over by ZLearn and at the valuations which have been questioned by many in the market as well. Let's take it straight to the two experts joining me on the show this week. And we have with us Mr. Amit Tandon as well as Mr. Sandeep Parekh. Gentlemen, so good to have you on the show. The first question, Mr. Tandon, of course, this has been seen that shareholders have been given the majority of minorities, so that gives them a lot of power. But what do you make of deals like Treehouse, ZLearn, where in a few months the valuation of Treehouse has been brought down by 85% and the shares on the stock exchanges have also aligned with the kind of swap ratio that have really come up to it?
Well, you could either say that it's the efficient market hypothesis playing out, or you could say that the insider trading is so pervasive in the market that the market always knows what's going to be happening. You could take your pick in terms of either of the two things. But, you know, what's interesting is that when you go back and I go back and think about the transaction, I think what they initially announced was that the effective date of the merger will be 1st April 2016. And therefore, at the time of announcing the deal, both sides had actually kept themselves or given themselves some wiggle room to see that, look, if that 53-for-10 shares swap ratio doesn't work, then there is a scope for changing it. And I guess what they've used is the intervening time to go back, do a due diligence, come back on the numbers. We've also seen the numbers which were reported by Treehouse for the quarter, which was significantly down from what they'd reported for the same quarter last year.
Mm-hmm.
So that actually is seeing itself, playing itself out. So, yes.
As a regulator, SEBI probably can do much more so that the stock price is more reflective of the inherent value and the issues in a particular company. And we don't need to need that company to really get into an M&A kind of a situation, then do due diligence, and then find the real value of that particular company.
Obviously, the market, efficient markets are predicated on the fact that information is released to the public. But information is not released to the public on a minute-by-minute basis.
Hmm.
They will typically come out on a quarter-end basis or sometimes in more slightly more frequent basis.
But things being dramatically different.
Yeah, but let me add to that. But there has always been a buzz in terms of the numbers and whether the picture which is being presented to shareholders, is it the right picture or not.
Hmm.
And there were, at the time the annual report came out, there were a couple of analysts who had said that there are certain red, you know, they
raised the red flags.
They raised the red flags at that stage and said, let's look at the numbers a little bit more closely.
Mm-hmm.
So again, it's a question of, you know, people sitting down, doing, sitting down with the numbers, taking a hard look at what is happening, and then taking a call.
But do you think SEBI needs to act upon these kind of cases also?
If something like that happens after the diligence, I mean, there is an expectation that that price sensitive information is put in public domain before really the swap ratio in this instance, for instance, comes out in public domain. I think that piece of information ought to be. So I think that that's something which SEBI needs to kind of make much more clearer.
Mm-hmm.
That if there is information which is not yet entered the investor's knowledge, I think before the swap ratio, before the shareholder notice comes out.
Mm-hmm. So more disclosures, more transparency, definitely. And if it has been shared with a certain particular set of people, then why not to the shareholders of the company, especially the minority shareholders. But this, it's a season of mergers. We've seen many such cases right now. There are two big houses which are engaged in a merger situation of their two group entities. And there has been a lot of back and forth with the investors as well. Of course, there's a lot of power with the minority shareholders. What is the view coming in, Mr. Tandon, on Grasim Novo deal, which has raised, again, a lot of questions from the shareholders?
Yeah. You know, while the group has said that the motivation for doing it is to restructure the businesses and make it a little bit more efficient, is that really the motivation, or is the underlying motivation something else, i.e., is it to have you know, give idea access to the Grasim balance sheet so that they could raise more money? Is it the fact that to just increase the shareholding from about 31% to 39% for the family?
Promoted.
So those are the questions which are being asked at this stage.
And what do you think about, Mr. Tandon, the Cain Vedanta deal that is also getting to its closure, and the voting is going to be in early September? So what do you make of that? Because after 1 year of turbulation, then there was a sweetener added. Is it also setting a right precedent from the part of the minority shareholders' activism, where sometimes a sweetener is what is asked for from the companies? Is it also tying the hands of the corporates and the promoters, just being devil's advocate?
No, actually, this takes up from the you know, the earlier question you asked Sandeep, and which is the fact that you know, the whole change in regulations which empower the minority investors. At the end of the day, the company decides something. They may speak to a few investors, but they are reluctant to do so, just given the fact that you need to bring them across the wall, otherwise there would be insider trading charges. So they kind of sit in a room, decide what they think is correct, and therefore this whole process of a fairly long drawn, you know, from the announcement to when you approach shareholders for the final vote, it's a fairly long drawn time period. So it gives you a chance to engage with investors, to gauge their mood, and sometimes change the terms. So we've kind of seen that happen.
Finally, I wanted to just raise one more thing, Mr. Parekh. So we've all come out from an era when the minority shareholders had very little power, to now the related party transactions having majority of minority requirement, and that is giving them a lot of teeth. Are we up to the international standards when it comes to the rights of the minority shareholders, and how is it overall impacting the deal street?
answer your last question first, how is it impacting? I think obviously it's making some people very happy, some people very unhappy. So given that, I think it was pretty high time for minority shareholders who had no say at all. I mean, even if we had 30% shares in a company, you had virtually zero say in that company.
Right.
Today with 5 or 10%, you have a very substantial say.
Yes.
Which of course in some exceptional cases it can backfire in terms of, you know, investors
it's
may want.
It's the way you use the power in your hand.
Yes. So but broadly I think it's brought back the democratic process into companies where you have shareholders at the top, you have management below it, and you know the directors and management below it. So I think it's been a useful check and balance. It's made companies a lot more honest, to use your kind of a phrase, and I think it'll work out better for both for promoters and for shareholders in the long term, because you'll have well managed companies.
All right, so more power in the hands of the minority shareholders, but how effective it has been is one of the big questions, because at the end of it, what we are talking about is a numbers game, and these are financial wizards that we are dealing with, and you just have to add up numbers as well, is my analysis of the whole situation. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for coming with your expert take. With that, we'll slip into a short breather, but remember, the Deal Street is very active. We'll discuss some of the other big deals on the other side. Stay tuned to Big Deal.